He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave Explains.
Hey guys, for today I want to do a very straightforward synthesis problem here. We've got a starting material and a desired product, and we need to get there in three steps. So take a look at what we're working with and see what you can do. So let's see if we can put this puzzle together. Take a look at the desired product. We see that we're trying to get an alcohol here, and we're starting out with some alkene functionality. So we're probably thinking that we're working with addition reactions, maybe elimination reactions. We're trying to add things to pi bonds, maybe generate new pi bonds. And so what we're seeing is we could probably get this as an addition reaction if we had a pi bond here. Right, if we had a pi bond there, then we'd be in business, but we don't. We have a pi bond over here. So let's see if we can figure out a way to slowly shift that functionality up towards that portion of the molecule. So if we want to do, let's say, an addition reaction, we know we can do some different addition reactions with alkenes, and we want to try to get the action up there. We want to try to get functionality up in that part of the molecule. So let's say we do a hydrohalogenation. Now, what kind of hydrohalogenation do we want to do? We could do a Markovnikov hydrohalogenation or an anti-Markovnikov one. And if we want to have things going up in that direction, we might want to do a Markovnikov hydrohalogenation, because if we do that, that's going to set us up for continuing to move the functionality in that direction. So let's say we do that. And we get this situation here. Okay, so we've done a Markovnikov hydrohalogenation, and we've added H and Br, and the Br went to the more substituted carbon participating in that double bond. Again, because of the carbocation intermediate, we're going to proceed via the more stable carbocation intermediate. So if you want to go back and check out that tutorial, that will help explain that. So we've done our hydrohalogenation. And now what do we want to do? We're looking over here. We've identified that maybe if we get pi bond functionality there, we're going to be able to do some kind of hydration. But how are we going to do that? We want to get a pi bond, so clearly we're going to do some kind of elimination. So if we want to do an elimination, though, we want to think about the regiochemistry here. We want to think about what kind of elimination, because depending on what kind of base we use, we could get some different products. And so as it happens, we are going to want to use a very sterically hindered base. We're going to want to use a bulky base. So let's say we use tert butoxide, and maybe we would run that in tert butanol. And so the reason that we're going to want to do that is this, right? We've got some protons here. We've got beta protons there. We've got beta protons there. We've got beta protons here. But if we're trying to get that pi bond there, then we're going to need to, this has got to be kinetically controlled, right? Not thermodynamically controlled, because a small base is going to get one of these guys and just go back to where we started. And that's not where we want the pi bond. We want the pi bond up here so that we can do some addition and get that hydroxyl there. So we're going to need a big bulky base like tert butoxide. Tert butoxide is preferentially going to grab one of these guys and do E2 that way. And so that is what is going to get us to here, which is a much better situation, because now we have pi bond functionality where we want it to be able to do some desired chemistry. So once again, bulky base, that's how we did that. And now we know we want to do some kind of hydration, because we are primed. We've got this pi bond. If we add an H and an OH, then we are going to be able to get the product that we want. But do we want to do a Markovnikov hydration or an anti-Markovnikov hydration? Now, of these two carbons, this is clearly the more substituted than this one, and the OH ends up on the less substituted carbon. So what method do we know to do anti-Markovnikov hydration? Well, we've got our hydroboration-oxidation, right? That is the way that we know to do that. So we could put in these conditions here, right? That would be our hydroboration, and then we could do our oxidation. And we did go over that reaction and that mechanism in another tutorial. And so that would be our anti-Markovnikov, right? That's our anti-Markovnikov hydration. And that is indeed going to get us to this desired product. So this is a really great problem because it's a very simple transformation, but it makes you think critically, right? We know we're going to do some eliminations and some additions, but each step along the way, we're thinking about regiochemistry, right? We started here and we knew we needed to do some Markovnikov chemistry because we wanted to get the functionality here and not here. If we got the functionality here, then we'd be looking at these possibilities for pi bonds upon elimination, and then we're going the wrong direction around the molecule. We want to get going that way. So we did Markovnikov hydrohalogenation to get the bromine there, and the reason we did that is that gave us the option to do an elimination to get a pi bond there. We ended up doing a Hoffman elimination, right? This gave us our Hoffman elimination product, and that was the regiochemistry we wanted, because if we had used, say, sodium hydroxide, we would have gotten one of these protons instead and just been right back where we started. But we did terp butoxide, we went Hoffman, and that got us to this intermediate right here. And then from there, we knew that we wanted to do hydration, and we understood that we needed to do an anti-Markovnikov hydration. So we did our hydroboration oxidation, and we've got our desired product. So that's a nice little three-step synthesis. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.